I grew up at a time when the space race seemed to have influenced the design of everything around me. I was a child of the 70s. I was a massive science fiction fan. I was transfixed by TV and movies like 2001, Star Trek, and Star Wars. The design of the future seemed so exciting. It felt like we would all be living in houses that looked like this. Even the name of this house was Futuro. It was made from reinforced polyester plastic, and it was designed so that it could be mass-produced and situated in any location. As a child, I couldn't think of anywhere cooler that you might live. And what kind of car would you park outside this house? For me, there was only one choice. The legendary Ferrari Modulo. It was designed by Pininfarina, the Italian styling house, 44 years ago. And for me, it was a complete dream. The whole roof slid forward, so just climbing into it was an adventure. And what would you wear inside this car? This is not a car that you get into wearing jeans and t-shirts. No, no, no. Nothing less than one of Pierre Cardin's space people would look right sitting inside this car. 60s fashion designers like Cardin, André Courrèges, Paco Rabanne, they were really responsible for creating the future aesthetic look. They even suggested that people in the future might be wearing all-in-one jumpsuits. I mean, as if. Their vision, these futuristic fashions, were made from materials like molded plastics, synthetic fibers, all kinds of vinyl. But those space-age materials relied on a petrochemical industry, which was creating new polymer science. And those designs weren't, in fact, very sustainable or indeed practical. The Futuro house had to be taken off the market in the mid-1970s because of the oil crisis, which made the production prohibitively expensive. The modulo car, well, it was only ever a concept. It was far too low to be road legal, and in fact, it could only drive in a straight line. As for plastic clothes and synthetic fibers, well, if you've ever worn them, you know that they don't breathe. They're not very comfortable. So, you know, they had limitations. As a child, my future, plastic fantastic future, really didn't include a world that looked like this. Several decades later, we know that those so-called future materials really wasn't a sustainable pattern of behavior. We know today that we need to radically rethink raw materials, manufacturing, consumption, and so forth. I did follow my childhood dream to be a designer, and I went into fashion. But I continued being excited by science and technology. But what I was looking for was a vision for the future which was positive in some way. And I started to research what that long-term future vision might be. And I wrote a book about the future of fashion, but not about what we might wear next season, but what we might be wearing in 50 years' time. One of the things I discovered in researching that was that if you want to find out about the future, don't ask a designer, ask a scientist. One of the most interesting people I met was a biologist. And when I put it to him that I was searching for the future vision of fashion, he replied, "You could grow it." He explained that microorganisms, like bacteria and yeast, can also produce textile-like fibers. They don't need to grow in a field. This can happen in a liquid. Wow, here was a vision of the future that I had never seen or heard of before, a dress emerging from a vat of liquid. So I no longer work with this. Instead, I work with this. My threads went from being visible to invisible, but essentially the material is the same. It's cellulose. I no longer think about cloth in terms of oil or fields. I think about it in terms of microbes and recipes. So this is a recipe for a jacket. Sugary green tea, some microbes, and a little thyme. So this is a fermentation solution. The dark shadow that you can see at the bottom is a living organism. It's a symbiotic mix of yeast and bacteria that, when they feed on the sugar nutrient, spin nanofibrils of cellulose. And these come together and form fibers. Over time, that forms a thick mat on the surface. So these are growth baths set up in my design studio. On the left, you can see it just set up. So there's the living culture just been put in, and there's a sensor that regulates the temperature. 2 weeks later, there's the material that's formed on the surface. When it's ready and I'm happy with the thickness, I just wash it out and lay it on a wooden board so that it can air dry. And something which is 2 centimeters in thickness when it's wet will, once all the water is evaporated, will dry down to be less than 0.5 millimeter in thickness. And depending on the recipe and how it's made, it can feel anything like a paper to something which is more like a leather texture, which means that you can cut it and sew it like you might a conventional garment. So here is a garment which has been hand sewn together just as it's emerging from a vat of indigo. And this is it finished. So this is a jacket which is just made from sugary tea and some microbes. That means it's completely compostable. So if you wanted to, you could throw it out with your vegetable peelings and it will naturally biodegrade. Or you could think of it like this. Instead of throwing it in the washing machine with some soap, what would happen if you put in some microorganisms and some nutrient solution? What if instead of washing your clothes, you fed them? Some bugs would eat the dirt, so they would clean the garment, but others might start to actually grow onto the existing structure. So what would happen if you could actually regrow something? If you get bored of it, don't throw it away, grow it into a different shape. As a designer, I now am excited about a future around living materials. We're just at the start of biology and design coming together, creating all kinds of exciting new materials. And there are many people doing this kind of work. For example, people are actually looking at making silk into a liquid that you can put into a 3D printer so that you could make something like a pair of spectacles. There are people taking the waste crops from something like carrots and turning it into an organic carbon fiber-like material so that you can make something tough, like a skateboard. If you could harness organic materials from the natural world, what would you choose to make with it? Personally, I would quite like a mother-of-pearl version of one of these. And how did you come here today? Maybe you wore one of these. So creating consumer products from biomaterials it has many advantages. Obviously, we need to make products which can be easily and safely biodegraded. But what if we could actually harness the unique qualities of those materials? I'm not talking about mimicking nature. The future of design is going to be about working with and improving upon what's there already. So emerging science like synthetic biology is enabling us to think about how we might actually engineer new additional beneficial functions into organic matter. So returning to your cycle helmet, let's imagine a future where it's not based on an oil-based plastic, but instead was made by this guy. Thank you very much.